Matthew chapter 12. There's always family here, and we welcome those of you who are family that have come to witness the testimonies of Cole and Eric, and later on today, four other individuals will get baptized in the next service, and we'll have family there as well. Family that are a part of this family, and family that are simply a part of the family of the individuals who are getting baptized. And I have to tell you that one of the hardest and yet necessary things that I've ever had to do as a believer was to declare my allegiance to Jesus to my family. That's always a hard thing to figure out. Why is that so hard? I got a text this last week from someone who we had a mutual friend that was sharing her testimony with her family for the first time and how hard it was for her, even though she's happy to share her testimony any other time. I don't have the easy answer for that, but probably just the threat of what could occur as a result of our allegiance to a greater family. And for me, this is what the issue is about today, and the cliffhanger is just our allegiance to a greater family. When I placed my faith in Jesus, I learned that there was a greater family that I became a part of, where there were other brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers that became a part of my life. Christians refer to Matthew 28 as the Great Commission. It's not, the phrase Great Commission doesn't mean better. It just means greater, bigger, broader. When Jesus originally gave a commission to his disciples, he sort of narrowed it. He said, here, don't go to anybody else. Just go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Remember that? But then he says, go later on to all the nations and make disciples. That's a great commission. Not a better one, just a greater, broader, bigger commission. In that sense, those who place their faith in Jesus to be their Savior become a part of a greater family, a bigger, broader family that incorporates a large number of people where everything changes, changes even in your allegiance to your natural family. It doesn't mean that you love your natural family less. In fact, in many cases, in most cases, you should love them more. But it doesn't always seem that way to the natural family, does it? If you were with us last week, we were in John chapter 7, where the Lord Jesus is told by his family to go express himself, go make yourself known to everybody. The great feast is upon us of tabernacles. And they were utterly disingenuous. They didn't understand. They didn't get it. Not at that time, anyway. Well, that same family shows up in the scene here at the very end of Matthew 12, and we'll pick it up in verse 46. Similarly, they are not a part of the greater family as of yet. So in my thinking, as I understand the scripture, they're not there yet. And it's pretty evident when you read while verse 46, he was still speaking to the people. Behold, his mother and his brother stood outside asking to speak to him. But he replied to the man who told him, who is my mother and who are my brothers? And stretching out his hand toward his disciples that were in that house, that packed place, here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and brother. Or mother, rather. Now, a text out of context is a pretext, as someone has said. And verse 46 says, while he was speaking to the people, and that takes us back to what had to be one of the hardest days in the life of Jesus. If we were to read all of Matthew chapter 12, we would find Jesus in one confrontation after another, one hard word after another, one judgmental statement after another. In fact, in verse 40, I'm sorry, verse 9 and following, it says, he went from there and entered the synagogue, and a man was there with a withered hand, and they asked him, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? So they might accuse him. In other words, they literally set up this miracle. Here's a guy with a withered hand. I'm not even sure he was looking to be healed. There's nothing in the text that says he was. They drag him into the synagogue, and as if to set up Jesus to heal on the Sabbath so they can accuse him. They say, hey, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? It's interesting because when Jesus responds to them, he's responding directly to his enemies, but he sees the guy with the withered hand, and it's almost like he says, stretch your hand out. It's almost in anger that he does it. Stretch your hand out. The guy goes and does the one thing he couldn't do. And instant, there's a miracle there. Later on in verse 34, he calls them brood of vipers. He talks about the fact that they accuse him of casting out demons by the devil himself, Beelzebub. And Jesus says, this is the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit you're guilty of. This is the kind of confrontation he's having one with another. And finally, just before we get to the text we're on, he says to these enemies, listen, there is something greater than Jonah, the great, revivalist prophet, and there's something greater than Solomon, the wisest man to ever live, is here right now. This is all that's going on. And he's in a home where it's just literally packed out. In fact, as if that's not enough, he's got enemies all around him. His family shows up. And in the midst of all, they show up. And Mark's account tells us what was going on in their heads as they made their way from their house to this other house where Jesus is preaching to a packed audience. Mark tells us in chapter 3, verse 21, it says, and when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, he's out of his mind. Have you ever read that? This is Mary. These are his brothers and sisters. They're going, well, let's go get him. The poor man doesn't know what he's doing. He's crazy. Picture this. Mark also tells us the place is packed. It's a mixed audience. You got admirers. You have wonderers. You have seekers. You have critics. You have haters. You have conspirators. All in this setting. I was thinking about that. What if that was the case every time I got up here to preach? Now, I'm sure I've got all kinds of people here that are thinking, just get it over with. Others thinking, please give me more. Some of you are going, I need to hear more about this. And some of you may just be just spitefully, just hateful. How should I respond as a pastor to you? What if I know that some of you are enemies and conspirators? Somebody showed me this YouTube clip here the other day. I'll just show you a little bit of it. Real story. This is not a setup. This is not a joke. Just listen up.
Son, don't go to sleep while I'm talking. Hey, hey, hey. Don't you lay your head back. I'm important. I'm somebody. Now, you might do your English teacher that way, but I'm not teaching English. I'm teaching eternal life here. I love you. You know I love you. Have I convinced you I love you? Yeah. You better nod your head. Yes. All right. Come on. Put it right there. All right. You stay awake and you listen to me. You say, well, he may never come back. Well, he ain't here now. And where have you been, Mr. Underwood? And I noticed on the calendar I'm supposed to marry y'all. What makes you think I'd marry you? You're one of the sorriest church members I have. You're not worth 15 cents. And you want me to marry you to her? And you want to marry him? And he don't even know where he belongs? And you don't even know where you belong? Now, let me tell y'all, everybody here.
The reason Doug cut that off, because before he's done, he gets to after the guy in the sound room. You got a little club going back there? Wow. Now, it's true. It might be true that we have a mixed audience here. There always is. But I don't have to call you out personally. If I'm preaching the Word of God, the Holy Spirit will do that. And some of us here have witnessed that, right? Where, oh my goodness, you're just like hammering on me. Now, in the midst of all of this, Jesus is preaching to this mixed audience of people, getting all kinds of reactions. His family shows up. And they're sort of on the outside looking in, literally, but also spiritually, more ways than one, shall we say. The things they have heard about Jesus are upsetting. They're embarrassing to the family, causing a public stir. They're not so much concerned about the message he's preaching as they are the trouble he's stirring. But they can't even get into the place. Their heads are sort of bobbing up. They're trying to get in, and suddenly some guy sees that they're out there, and he alerts Jesus as to who has showed up late for the service. It's your family, Jesus. After my conversion to Christ, my family showed up. Not while I was preaching, but to my home. I got a large family, and they showed up one after another, and just a train of individuals, starting with my dad. I got letters, I got phone calls, I got nasty letters. And then my dad showed up. And my dad sat there and he said, "Pat, in 6 months you'll get over this." As if I had a cold or something, or a virus. But outsiders looking in never see things very clearly. I was thinking about this. Do you remember when the Apostle Paul was saved? Do you remember how he was saved? He's going to Damascus. He's going to try to lasso a bunch of Christians and drag them back to court. And he's already overseen the death, the stoning of Stephen. And Jesus appears to him. Remember that? He's knocked down by this voice, this bright light. And now Paul would tell his testimony a number of times. And when he does so in Jerusalem, in Acts chapter 22 and verse 9, he tells it, he puts a little nuance on it. He says that those around him heard the voice, but they didn't, what? They didn't understand it. Which is exactly where some of you are. You're hearing the voice of God. Not me, the Bible, the truth of God, the gospel of God. But you're hearing the voice of God, but you don't grasp it. You don't accept it. You don't understand it. You're like Jesus' family, or your outsiders looking in. I was at a workshop a few weeks ago, and I was teaching on evangelism. I was grateful the place was packed. I had a great time. Afterwards, people were talking to me. We were talking about the subject matter and whatnot. And an old friend showed up, and he's kind of a smart aleck. And he says, "Yeah, way to go. Good workshop there, Nemers." And I looked at him, I said, "Thanks. I didn't notice you were in the workshop." He says, "I wasn't. I was next door, but I heard everything you were saying." Alluding to the fact that my voice is loud. But really what he was saying was he heard my voice. He did not hear the content because there was a wall between us. And that's really what's going on in some of your lives. You're hearing things, but it's not getting through because there's a wall between you and God. The wall of sin. And that's what's going on here. So, here is a situation where his family shows up. And he's actually having a sort of a indirect conversation with them by talking to those in front of him. I mentioned a woman earlier in the message about who recently became a Christian, freely sharing her story with others, but struggling in sharing it with her parents, asked us for advice. She called her parents just the other day, and when she did, she got pretty much what she expected. They poo-pooed her story. They just sort of, you know, one said they would gave sort of lip service to listening. The other just said, "Well, you know, you join the church, other people join the country club." We all get excited about something. And I shared with her because she was discouraged, but even before the call, I shared with her these words from Matthew chapter 10, where the Lord Jesus said these words. He said in Matthew chapter 10, and you can just go back a page if you want to, where he says in verse 34, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace, but a sword. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. But for I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will," what? "Will find it." And so Jesus told us this, but he was living this out as well. So here he is teaching. Somebody comes, "Hey, Rabbi, your mom and your siblings are outside. They're trying to get in." This scene, by the way, would repeat itself in other ways throughout the narratives, throughout the Gospels. And it's interesting, in this section, there's no miracle here. He's just teaching. The only reason this segment of Scripture made it into the Scripture itself is because of what or how Jesus responded to his family being there. So that you and I might grasp the importance of the greater family. That's the reason it's in here. So look what he says. He says, "Who?" Look at it. "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" He stretches out his hands. They're right here. They're right here. Right where? Inside, while the mom and brothers are outside. Now, I know commentators will say, "Now, he really wasn't being disrespectful." I don't know about that. I read this and I see a mom and siblings getting offended by this. Wouldn't you be? Well, Jesus was just simply expressing the greater. Yes, he was talking about the greater family, the new relationships, but these things hurt, do they not? I've heard it said that tact is the art of making a point without making an enemy. Well said, but not entirely realistic. Not when it comes to gospel ministry. I once shared Christ very lovingly with a man who turned right around and told his wife that I told him he was going to hell. I never once said he was going to hell, but he figured it out. If I take Jesus' words literally, and I do, no amount of tact will assuage for the pain the gospel can do and bring to a family. You can't sugarcoat the truth. Oh, actually, you can. And many try to, especially the family, but the gospel by design cuts. And those cuts run deepest in the family, do they not? So stretching out his hand, he says, "Here. Here's my mother and my brothers," clearly identifying with his followers. Listen, Jesus was not denouncing his family. He was announcing a greater family. And here's the clincher. "For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven," that's my mother, or my brother, my sister, and my mother. And so then, this is what I want you to listen to as we bring this to a conclusion. As you listen to those stories in the baptismal, the key to entering the greater family of God, the one that Jesus alludes to, those who had embraced him within that home, is to do the will of Father God. This isn't the only time he expresses it like this. How important it is for you to do the will of God. How important is that? Well, you say for a Christian it's important. No, for a non-Christian it's important. That's how you get into the family, by doing the will of God. Did you know that? Jesus described a judgment day like none other when he said, "Not everyone who says, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter into the kingdom of God, but he who does the will of my Father." Many will come to me in that day. And you, some of you, could be in this group. God help you. Saying, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Cast out demons in your name? Do many wonders in your name? And Jesus said, I will reply. I'll say, I never knew you. Strong words. What is the will of the Father? It's very simple. And Jesus put it like this. This is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him should have eternal life. I'll raise him up on the last day. And after all, if you don't get raised up, you're toast. This is the will. Look at it. This is the will of my Father. You look. You don't just say. You look. Look unto me and be saved. All the ends of the earth, Isaiah said. This is what Jesus affirmed. This is the will. This is what you must do. You must look at the Son. You must believe. You'll get eternal life. You will be raised up in the last day. What did Jesus' family do with this? We don't know. The narrative drops off. The real question as you insert yourself into this cliffhanger is this. You know what it is, don't you? What will you do? Let me give you four truths about God's greater family and we'll be done. One, God's greater family is blood related. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off, far away from God, but now you've been brought near to him through the blood of Christ. So now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You're citizens along with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family, the greater family, I might add. The greater family of God is blood related. Here's the second thing. God's greater family has no racial, religious, social, gender, or even political barriers to it. As Paul writes, for in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. There's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. There's no male, no female. All are one in Christ Jesus. That's glorious, isn't it? From the richest guy to the poorest pauper, everything in between. You can be in the greater family of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Thirdly, God's greater family is hallmarked by love for one another, right? Let brotherly love, say it, continue, right? Vance Havner said there are fundamental fellowships that are right in their dispensations and wrong on their dispositions. At no time in the history of the church was love characterized like those first three centuries. Even the Romans took note of it. Tertullian wrote that the Romans were constantly saying, see how they love one another. When Jesus replied the way he did, think about this. When Jesus, you know, hey, your family's outside, your mom, your brother's out there. When Jesus says, who are my mother and my brothers? Here is my mother, my brothers, my sister. I know what we're thinking. Oh, man, what a diss. Whew. Now reverse it. Can you imagine how affirming that would have been to his disciples as he put his hand over his disciples and said, These are my brothers. These are my sisters. These are my mothers. God's greater family is hallmarked by love for one another. And some of you long for that kind of love and acceptance, and it's right here in the family of God, the greater family of God. And finally, God's family, greater family, requires a birth certificate, right? Jesus said, one of the first cliffhangers we did to Nicodemus, "Truly, truly, verily, verily, most assuredly, I say to you, I say to you, I say to you, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the greater family. You can't see the kingdom of God." Mary and Jesus' brothers were on the outside looking in, just like some of you. They were in the lesser family. Now we know that Mary, we know that James, and we know that Jude would become a part of the greater family of God. The real question is, are you? Will you? Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for the greater family of God and all that it entails. Where there is neither Jew nor Greek, there's neither slave nor free, all are one in Christ Jesus. We say, hallelujah, thank you, Lord. I pray for those, Lord, who are here on the outside looking in. They've heard words, even your words, Lord. They've heard testimonies. And yet it's a little bit like being on the other side of the wall. They're hearing the noises, but it's not getting through. Oh, God, Holy Spirit, work through that sin barrier and get to those hearts here today. Cause individuals to see the great need for the greater family, brought to us by the great Savior himself, the one who loved us, died on that cross, and rose again for our sin, even the Lord Jesus. May we love the greater family, Lord. Not love our earthly families less. And Lord, help this message not to be perceived as some carte blanche toward tactless speaking, preaching, proclaiming. No, we need to lovingly appeal to people. But we recognize, Lord, it will cut deep when it comes to our family. So be it. Do your work, dear God, raising up your Son's name greatly in our midst, we pray in his name.